everyone, this is Sonali. Thank you all for carving out some time for attending today's webinar on the episode 24 of the BusinessX learning series, Invest, Scale, Value and Exit. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to welcome our speaker, Mr. Gaurav Marya, Chairman and Founder of the Franchise India Group. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, Sonali, and thanks for hosting this session. And my apologies for missing out the last session because of some emergency. So this is a 24th session where we talk about every time a different topic. So sometimes we talk about how to scale your business. Sometimes we talk about how to exit your business. We talk about investing and value. So today's topic is value. You know, I will do a little bit of refresher in terms of what needs to be done when people are looking to value their businesses. And I feel that this is a very critical time. A lot of companies, a lot of business owners are looking to value their businesses for various reasons. And they're looking for a future investment in the business. They're looking for, getting an M&A situation. They want to look at an exit from a business. And multiple reasons, I think you need to really value your business. And it is good to continue to value your business and see where you stand and how the business is performed and so on and so forth. And I feel that most of the times, if you're running a business and you don't know the value, you're actually driving a ship which has actually you've not gone into, say, understanding why you're doing it. Because end of the day, therefore, any business to really perform and see, there should be end of the tunnel. You know, there should be end of the tunnel for shareholders to really see where they're going to exit or they want to find some long-term value from the business. And that's very important. And now these days, we get a lot of companies reaching out to us and have a perception about themselves in terms of the value. They've not gone and taken advice from somebody who's a professional. And now it is required to have a professional registered valuator who would come and work on your asset and understand what the value really do that. So today's session, we will divide this into three parts. One, I'll take you through what I call the 10 areas, which to me set the valuation of any organization. These are very, very important aspects, and you need to really maybe make a notes on that, that what are the 10 points which you need to really see where you stand in your businesses. And they would be really very, very critical when you are putting up a valuation of the business. And then we'll go into a little bit of what you need to do to structure your valuation document. It's called information memorandum. What all needs to be covered on that, what kind of information is required on that. So that would become the second part. Valuation document, what are the checklist which you need to really have for your valuation document. So let's get started. And in the meantime, if you have any questions for me, you can go on a Q&A box and just ask those questions. And we'll be more than happy to really advise you on that, or any information you would require, we'll be more than happy to help you on that. So Q&A box on the bottom, just go on and ask your question. And I'll at the end of the session would be happy to take that. So the 10 points which would set the valuation for your business are following. One, you need to really discover your inherent strength. This is very important. This is actually connecting a lot of dots to really come down to a point where you have this inherent strength. And this is, to me, sometimes a missing point. You know, we think that businesses are just about top line and bottom line. The answer is no. There is much more to any business and much more to this and that. And that's why it gives you surprising. A lot of these young startups sometimes get a phenomenal amount of valuation because there is something which is much more inherent in the business model, which is so attractive to our investor to value it at a certain level. And sometimes large businesses, family-run businesses running for many, many years don't get that kind of valuation just because they have run the business purely as a commodity and like a trading company. Like if you are a trading company or an importer, you buy something in and then further sell it out. You more or less are doing a dollar plus kind of a model, cost plus model kind of a structure. And you are a pass through. You have no inherent value, which you are building in. And that's something which is sometimes looks like a good income businesses, but they don't have any sort of valuation. I've seen businesses which are 500 crore in turnover, 1,000 crore in turnover. But really, if you go out and see the valuation of the businesses, they have nothing. They are just pass through in that nature. So what you need to ask yourself is what kind of a business advantage you really bring in? What advantage you are bringing in? Are you a entry barrier to somebody? A lot of businesses eventually get successful. Like these days, EV is becoming a very big space, the electric vehicle space. And I've been approached by about, not more than, I mean, I think should be about 20 odd companies which have approached us. And these are startups and some mature companies. Now, mature companies are running for larger market share, quickly go in the market and capture as many markets you need to do that. And sometimes these early stage companies also want to follow the same route, which I'm advising not to do that. I'm saying, go and take up one city. One of the companies was in Goa. And I said, just follow Goa itself. Create an entry barrier in Goa. Don't go and put your dealerships everywhere. You cannot service them. You will not be able to launch your products. You will not be able to do aftermarket. Don't even worry. You know, go and focus on one market and create a stronger entry barrier in that. Somewhere when the consolidation would start happening, which would happen, I think, 2 years from now, 2.5 years, 3 years from now, where we will see a lot of acquisition happening in this space. Currently, there are about 100 different startups which have come in the market. I think 100 more would emerge. So these 200 would actually then come down to 20, 30, and then eventually to the game 8, 9, the big boys would be there in that. So there would be some players which would go that high. And you have big competition. You have Ola announcing that they're doing a 2,500 crore plant investing into e-vehicles. You have some other companies today. I saw Bajaj saying that they also want to put up a big plant with Maharashtra government with 650 crore investment. So the big boys are also coming. But if you're building your market share quickly, then you will get a chance to do that. But you need to go deeper and create an entry barrier. Another thing which is always I like about businesses, that what kind of problem they are solving. What is the larger problem they are trying to solve? And how this can help even other organizations to really go out and capture you, because you have actually addressed that problem and you're very close to solving the problem. And this is where one of the companies I advised was actually a company which used to do business on diabetics, and a big insurance company really saw a value in them, because they had a huge amount of data of people who were diabetic, and this was a health insurance large company, and they felt that data can play a very important role for them and things of the nature. Sometimes you have some problem which you're solved, and that problem or that which can help other businesses to look at it. So you need to really see what problem your business is trying to solve. That's one point. So discover your inherent strength and just play on that and make sure that you are much deeper into that rather than just going wider and spreading thin. The second piece to me is obviously profitability. You know, in short time or a midterm, you need to really show profitability. It's not no more a system, especially post-COVID. No, but everybody is interested to really look at a very, very long-term profitability gains. They're looking at sometime in short term or looking at a midterm of profitability. Where do you really stand? How do you really demonstrate the profitability? That's very important. Third is, how do you demonstrate your increasing of cash flows and margins? Again, these are two different parts. You know, a lot of people are able to demonstrate their increased cash flows, but they're not able to really give answers on how they would improve their margins. To me, this is more important. Cash flows is still in a strategy base, more marketing, more advertising, more markets to go. You can still increase your cash flows. But how do you going to demonstrate that you're going to improve your margins is more important and more valuable. Fourth point is, how do you want to go and unlock your value in which markets you want to go? So one of the areas which is very exciting for me is that, are you making a brand which is global? And if that is the case, then one of the markets you want to do, at what phase you would like to go? This is very, very important to me. And if a good investor, especially global investor, wants to look at it, he would like to look at it, how much this business model has a strength to spread, how far it can go. And that's something which is becoming, the big is becoming larger, the larger is becoming very, very large companies. So that's how the scale is going. Look at the companies like Oyo Rooms. I mean, they can go to 80 countries very, very fast. While there is challenges in the business now, but fundamentally this business model was extremely globally scalable. So why would you not have an opportunity which can go into multiple markets? Think a much larger spread can come to your businesses. Finally, fifth point is, how do you really do what I call your diversified consumer base? You cannot be just focused on one. And like these days, if you were to say a supplier to one industry, say you were doing something with hospitality and hospitality is shut, And then what would you do? So if I was a technology product and only doing hospitality, and then if this has been now in that stage, your business is eroded. So you need to really see, how do you diversify your current consumer base? The sixth point is, how do you demonstrate controls and compliances in your business? a lot of good businesses really lack this part. So they don't really put emphasis on control and compliances. Any good startup these days, I am looking at it, has a strong financial control. And they demonstrate that financial control in depth. And that's something which investors love it. I've seen a lot of investors walked out of deals because they felt that the business was a little bit of mystery. They didn't understand that how it was really, I think, or it was too close to the control with the founder. And founder was running businesses like his own thing, not as an independent enterprise. And investors don't want to touch it. Another area which is very important, which is the seventh point, is that how is your resistance towards not becoming commoditized? Maybe you are at this stage sitting on a business model which is uprising, great to move in, entire thing. But how do you ensure that your business would not become commoditized in coming time? What kind of differentiation you would continue to create so that you are able to retain your margins or improve your margins or retain your customers which would not move in just because you become commoditized? Now, sometimes it was brand. In the consumer days, it was brand. Sometimes it was technology. Sometimes it was something else which is very patent to you, which you have controlled the entire thing. So you need to really ask yourself, what is your control mechanism that your product or service would at a certain stage would not become commoditized? That you would have still a preference point to retain your customer, would not just move in because of somebody else is offering the same product cheaper than what you are offering or convenient what you are offering at this moment. Another area, which is eighth point, is predictability. How do you really bring predictability into business, which is what I call subscriber base or recurring revenue base? How is your recurring revenue base being demonstrated? How you are able to really demonstrate that the same customer would have multiple times buy, rather it will buy much more frequently in times to come and continue to improve their purchase value. So these are points which every investor really love, you know, because if you can demonstrate the same customer would buy over the time many times, would one try to buy more often, and second would also start buying and putting more money in every single purchase as we go along. Now that something is very, very exciting to me. This was the whole e-commerce story. E-commerce story was really to demonstrate, oh, I got these customers. They're currently buying only 300 rupees per customer. They would go to 1,000 rupees and they're only buying once in a month. They would start buying once in a week and then once every day. So if you are able to demonstrate that story, you become Amazon, right? So this is what everybody loves. Everybody loves the life of customer and continue to see that the purchase cycle is reducing. Earlier, you were buying only certain things on Amazon. Now you order almost everything which you consume daily. So now if the government would allow liquor, they would allow dairy, so all that would also start coming in the Amazon platform, because they would like to bring in customers' habit to come down to almost daily purchase. And that's where the value would really be built. Ninth point is, what is your replacement value? If somebody wants to get into the same business, but it would take a lot of time for them to get into, which you have already done, so you have a strong replacement value. I'm working on a deal where somebody is getting into a business and we are buying into some asset purely for the reasons. You can duplicate that business, but it will take you at least 1.5 years. So the replacement value was coming in that if we save that 1.5 years and we get a ready customer base, this is a good value. This normally happens in manufacturing. So you go on and acquire a manufacturing plant, because by the time you order machinery, your machinery would come in, you will establish the entire thing, get your plant licenses and all that. It will take a lot of time. So people would go and value something and just buy it out because they know that this there has a strong replacement value. And last, which is not the least, is that are you still a business which is totally dependent on the founder? And if that is the case, then also it's a very touchy point, because they don't like that. I mean, investors don't like that situation. They don't value those businesses. Businesses have to run by processes and systems. A good management team, which is very important, which creates a good value, but not overly dependent on any one individual. If it is a too much dependent on one individual, that would not run. That's why if you see healthcare practices which are run by a particular doctor, doesn't get a value because it's too much around him. And there is no way he can be redundant on that business. But healthcare practices like Apollo, where you are not dependent on one single personality, are valued much more. And that's where, because it's a healthcare brand and it's not really dependent on one professional or one practitioner. So this is the 10 points. I'll just repeat it again for anybody who's not made notes. Inherent strength, profitability, increasing cash flows and margins, unlocking value for new markets, diversified consumer base, control and compliances, resistance towards not being commoditized, bringing predictability, replacement value for the business, and what I call making the owner redundant in his own business. You don't have to really be dependent on that. Now, let's get into discussion on if you're creating your what I call business valuation report, what all needs to go there. Strong organizational structure, that's very, very important. You need to have one, obviously, you need to hire some professional to value your business. But once you've hired that, he would need to understand your organizational design. What is your organizational design? Who are the investors in the business? And what is the professional team within that team? That's very, very important. And what KRAs has been allocated to each of them, which has to be defined. Second piece is, who's your external consultants? Any advisors you have any kind of attorneys, CPAs, consultants, any kind of people on retainerships with you, all that has to be also very clearly defined. Then you need to also start working on building your financial statements, which would mean your last financial 5 years balance sheets, how the balance sheets are filed. On a quarterly basis, normally about 3 to 5 years of historic balance sheet, minimum of 3 years balance sheets are required. Then you need to also understand your organizational, your company structure, your legal identity. And a lot of people don't understand the difference. Sometimes they do. I mean, I'm seeing a lot of startups coming in, which are just limited partnerships, structures being used or still using some kind of what I call a sole proprietorship or things of that nature. It actually creates much more difficulty because one, conversion of these companies to a private limited companies is also a complex process. It looks very easy, but it is a very, very complex process. And most of these times when you are running these kind of firms, which are more partnerships and structures, there your individual returns would also be calculated. So those are also to be presented. And sometimes that becomes very weak points on these pieces. So really see that what kind of a legal identity structure which you're taking. Another, in last 3 to 5 years, any kind of litigations which you had in the business which were not resolved. And there's a lot of times these litigations look like very simple, because from a business owner viewpoint, when you run a business, you're prone to some kind of exposure. And you might have some notices which were lying, or some kind of cases with suits being filed which are not being addressed. Those can create a big roadblock. Because you might have your viewpoint on them, because you can see that that's not going to be too damaged entire thing. But from somebody who's looking to buy a business, they don't want to jump into the entire thing. So it can sometimes either stop the course of that investment, or sometimes it can delay, because they would have to then invite any kind of external legal advice on that. That should they go in, should not go in, what kind of exposure they are doing. And sometimes investors would like to hold some monies of transaction unless and until those are resolved. And this can take, especially in Indian courts, many, many, many years by the time the settlements can come, because there was a pending dispute. And now we saw one of the big deals which Reliance did with Future. They also, at that level, didn't understand that there was a side agreement being done with Amazon, which can create a trouble in this deal. And this can go even more complex going forward. And so it can be that they have captured that. They knew that if looking at Reliance as a company, they would 100% knew it. And they would have actually held a lot of monies to Future on that perspective. So my guess is that Future would not be paid those monies unless and until they are out of this whole thing. And which can actually further trouble Future, because they were selling those assets in that company purely to get some remittance coming from Reliance, and they would not do that unless and until this is over with them. So it can be actually for a seller, it can be a double trouble, because on one side you've gone, the business is gone. Second side, you not got your monies in the complete sense, because, and you are also now fighting legal structures outside. So you need to really see, is there any kind of a legal cases which are pending, which has to be very clearly defined and on upfront rather than being discovered. More it is told upfront, more it is better, because you're not getting into, I think, more it is discovered by anybody, it creates more complexity. So again, intellectual property rights, kind of patents you have, copyrights you have, trademarks you have, any kind of service marks you have, all that, at what stage they are, at what stage they need to be renewed, all the licenses which you've got, what stage they are, when they're going to be renewed, all that needs to be very, very clear. Now, very critical part we will discuss is these adjustments in your financials. You know, we get reports on financials every single day, and when we start reading those numbers, there are a lot of numbers which are good for our perspective, but they are not good for from a valuation viewpoint. They're weaker points. Sometimes in the say assets, some assets are not critical assets for the business itself. You know, there are assets which are available in the business, and people feel happy because they have bought some property or they have some cars on the in the balance sheet, and these look like an assets, but they are not critical. They are not doing anything to the business. You know, business owners buy these things because they want to put it into the company, but fundamentally it's not adding any value to the company. So when the valuation really starts or the investor looks at it, it takes out all the assets. So that has no meaning to entire thing. Sometimes extra cash, you know, people put FDs in businesses, and these FDs are lying there because you just want to hold some money. Normally this is discounted, and the earlier owners can really take that money, and only the working capital can be left in the business, which can be accounted for. So those are also not really part of the entire thing. Non-recurring income items. There are a lot of non-recurring income items. If you see the balance sheet of Unilever, every year they have sold some assets and they come in their incomes, right? So, but they're non-recurring, which means that if it was a building or some property lying there which you sold, it came in that year's income, and that would have to be removed because it would still not be a part of the business. It was a particular year or a quarter you had that impact because you sold something which was not required. So those are kind of things which have to be removed. And a lot of times this happens. I'm telling about even the company like Unilever. If you see the balance sheet of Unilever, you'll find that from last 15 odd years, they've almost been selling some assets, which they're older buildings and so on and so forth. So they do a lot of real estate like this. They sell some older ones and they buy new ones. There was always a structure which is available, which is good from a their financial structure viewpoint, but it is obviously not to be counted in the valuation structures. Any kind of wages, salaries, or benefits which are being done would be done at the current levels, not from the past levels. And also, like these days, I'm doing some valuation for businesses where they are talking about the current levels, which is not also realistic because, like say, for pre-COVID, you were on a rental of 9 lakh rupees. Now, because you negotiated for 6-7 months, your current rental load is lesser. You're also paying some salary cut to your employees. But we will have to see the pre-COVID numbers structure. Owner salaries is a big, big challenge. Owner salaries are normally counted. A lot of times people would say, oh, because I did my own personal withdrawal, that is part of the profitability. That becomes very complex to really answer. So don't do all that pieces. These were a classic style of businesses. No more it has valuable in that. Uncollectible amounts, which have expired. So things which have not been collected and don't look like to be collected, it sits in your receivables, also have to be taken out. Or any liabilities which you would have can potentially come out. You might feel that it's not going to be impacting, but might come back on the business at a later stage. And especially when the big companies buy into smaller units, looking at the larger company coming in, which has to be more compliant, as more exposed as a legal identity, a lot of unseen, unregistered liabilities in the system would start rising up. So normally they would give a cooling period and they would do those announcements, hold some money, and suddenly you start seeing notices from people coming in, look, I had this liability, this number, and it can become very, very complex. Even a company like Ranbaxy was sold at a phenomenal valuation, the big story at that time, and later the new owners got into huge trouble because they got so much coming out from liabilities which was not recorded, receivables which were shown was never got, patents which were told in the US was existing was expired. So a lot of challenges really started coming in, and they had almost 20 years of war, a legal war, and eventually they won. And there was a big penalties to be passed on to the earlier owners because of the misrepresentation of their facts and so on and so forth. Finally, you also have to really talk about how your industry review, what is your industry telling you, where do you stand in your own industry, how you're positioning towards your competition, where are you in terms of your competitive analysis, how much advantage you have over your competition and things like that. That's very, very important, because this would really come out to be one of the most important aspects, because most of the times a strategic buyer would really look at who else is available in the system and why you versus any other asset they want to really acquire. So what you bring in as a special advantage to your competitive landscape. Now, finally, I'll just do a summary of, if you are writing your own information memorandum, following should be the cases which you need to really put as a head. First, put a brief history about your business. Sharp, but don't go overdo it, but talk about your history of the business from where you founded, what was the reason you to found, to where it is, and what is the future looks like. And that's how your business has to be defined. Go into very detail of very clear, sharp product information. Don't go too much outside, but go very sharp on the product information or a service information. What do you stand for? What is your value proposition? Who's your target group? Why the target group would continue to buy you, and so on and so forth. Finally, your market position, your brand, where it stands, how your market is perceiving you, what is your customers telling you, or have they have any kind of data which tells you that they have increased or their purchase decisions with you or continue to do that. So especially last 4 quarters, what are they telling you? It's an upward trend, which is very important. You need to also talk about your employee and vendors, suppliers, databases, all that organizational design, very sharp design, how it is done, what is the vintage, who are the critical resources, what are the process center owners. Each process is owned by somebody who's run that. What is his background? How much domain experience comes to really contribute that piece? Who's your primary competitors in the structure? So you need to have a very strong competitive graphing where you position yourself in your it can be quality versus price, it can be markets, it can be features, it can be multiple graphs. People like to understand where you are versus anybody else in the market and where do you see the bigger chunk of consumer bases and which you're trying to address. You need to also do a lot of physical demonstration in your IAM. I sometimes see a lot of data, but doesn't show a lot of pictures and so on and so forth. So use as many pictures you want to do that. It's much more better when you're representing to people to see through what you have built. And most of the time, especially on the initial pitch stage or initial valuation, people are reporting the entire thing. They like to see the brand experience, right? So they need to really see the brand experience. They just won't want to read data. Data would come obviously when they start the DD process. And also any other critical information, don't indulge too much in the first IAM, too many information about the business. It is not worth. It will go down to when the DD process starts, when they would start dipping into much more and deeper into the business. So this was about valuation. We talked about the 10 critical points, which are the foundational points for your valuation. We talked about what is the data which you require to compile when you're putting up a valuation. And then finally, what should go into your information memorandum document. So this was today's session. So I'd like to invite Sonali to have any questions for me. And Sonali, over to you, please.
For a wonderful and insightful session, Gaurav sir, as always, it's been a pleasure having you with us. And yes, I would now like to take up a few questions that we have. So the first question that we have is, how to actually improve my valuation if I'm planning to sell as soon as possible? What is a realistic time period for improving the valuation in documents?
I don't know what is a time period you're looking at to sell a business, but I think give yourself a lead time of 180 days. That is a rightful lead time for any kind of a value to term sheet kind of a situation. But I feel that even if you want to get realistically valued yourself, there is also another 120 to 180 days time. So if I have to really see somebody valuing and then looking for a right kind of investor or a complete M&A situation or an exit situation, then you should give yourself a good 1 year kind of a scenario. And that means that the first 6 months is a lot of preparation time. Now, to change the second part of your question was that how to improve your valuation. You know, I feel that it has to have to do with your business model. How do you really address your business model? How do you fine tune a lot of things? You know, I'm these days advising one restaurant chain, which obviously wants to either exit or bring in another investor to partial exit of their current investors. And I had some sitting with them, and one of the areas which the founder told me is that he was surprised that the lot of inefficiencies they were running in the business, which they worked last because of forced work because of COVID. So they were working on, say, 15 people. They now started working with 7 people, and they had a lot of back of the house, and where they were producing everything live. Now they created a central kitchen where everything they did is frozen or another technology, which is now has cut down their expensive cost people. So they don't have to have chefs. So they have worked on a business model to really turn around and show that the business is much more sustainable, high growth, and also would improve the margins as we go along. So these are a couple of things which investors like. Investors like to invest in future. How do you become future ready? That's something to me is very important. So you need to really go back and retwist your business model. Sometimes we don't do it when we're running. When we start designing the business model for building value, we need to really go out and say, how do I make the business model future ready? In future, it can run. Another thing which you need to really do is make the business model process oriented, so you're not required in the business, so that business can be transferred. Sometimes, you know, if it is too dependent on you and around you, and a lot of your own personal skills are required every single day in your business, then it will not be able to multiply or find the right kind of business.
Sure. Next question we have is, how to create the valuation report for a startup which obviously has no historical data?
It's much easier, actually. If you really ask me, you know, it's like doing a painting, right? So it's much easier for you to really, put kind of, obviously it has to be research based. You need to do a lot of research. You need to do some kind of comparative analysis. There, I think you need to fundamentally demonstrate 3 things. One is what the problem you are trying to solve and how big is that problem and why do you think that problem needs solution right now? You know, some problems are there. Everything has a problem, right? And pollution is a problem, right? This is a problem. Everything is a problem. But sometimes the demand is not urgent. Demand is not now. Demand has to be addressed. Everybody knows it, but it's not really right now. I want to address this problem right now. So that's a situation one has to really understand and define. Then your own value, why you are the right person to solve that problem. Third, what would you require to solve the problem? So if you are able to justify these 3 things to investor in your presentation, then you're fine. So again, I'll repeat: problem, why you are the best guy today to solve that problem, and what all you require to solve the problem, which means that kind of capital, organization, team, technology, and all that. This is what people want to see. Maybe these are 3 slides. That's it.
Absolutely. And you have actually answered the next question within this question itself. But the question was, what information do I need to give in order to get valued? And is only the financial information required for it?
No. Financial information is actually 20% of that. 80% is a lot of other things which I've told in the 10 points in this piece.
Right. And again, following upon that, we have a question that says, is a confidential information memorandum mandatory for funding or valuation?
Yeah, it is. It is an essential document. Mandatory, I would not use a word, but it's not that it's required. It's a transaction between 2 private enterprises. So it is not mandatory, so to say, as a word, but you need to have it. This is your so to say, deck which you present for valuation, and if it is covered and done by somebody who is respectable on valuation, whose own credibility to do valuation is also very, and I think it creates much more weight on that.
And the last question many people have asked: if our company can help in creating a valuation report.
That's what Business X does. So please reach out to Sonali. She has a full team, and Business X has a full team. For business valuations, we have senior professionals who work with you on business valuation. We also have a fintech product called bizequity.com, which is world's number one valuation site. We are a joint venture partner for India. So that also is a product which creates a valuation for any business. And if you are looking to raise capital, you can also reach out to Business X. And if you are also looking to exit your business, then also Business X can help you.
Sure. So with this, we'll just wrap up the session. Thank you so much, Gaurav sir, for your time. It has been a pleasure, like always, to welcome you and hear your insightful thoughts on each of our topics every week. And I would also like to thank all our attendees. We really hope we were able to add some value to your lives through this session. And this is our last session of this year. And of course, it has been a difficult year for everyone, but everyone has come out stronger from it. So anything you would like to add in the end, sir?
No, I would like to wish everybody a very happy new year. We will see you in the next year. Every Saturday, we come back and we have these sessions. We are also trying to bring in some interesting more topics in the next series, which would start from next Saturday. And this is going to be every week, every Saturday structure. So it's good for when you are, it's a refresher for a lot of people who would like to know more about how to really structure the businesses. Businesses have changed. The way that people look at businesses have changed. The way the investors were there. Now the new investors, new age investors are very different. So it's good to really refresh yourself and continue to be updated on this. So stay tuned with BusinessX and we will continue to bring in fresher content for you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. With this, I'll just say everyone a very happy new year and thank you so much for your time.